What do you see as the solution to stopping the systemic racism that has been prevalent in the United States? This is a deep wound, and it will take a lot to heal it. How do you see the country coming together to heal?
I think you first have to recognize the problem before you can fix the problem. And many people don't necessarily want to recognize the problem. I mean, this country was founded on institutional racism and slavery. So until you address that and say, you know, this was wrong, we can't continue this, then you can't fix it. Lots of civil rights acts have been enacted, right? Like lots of them. You can't say, hey, people, don't be evil. Like, you can't just, you know, there's a law against that. You can't, that's not what it is. It's about changing people's hearts and then changing the societal structures that allow this to flourish.
I think that one thing that, you know, would definitely help our country move forward into, you know, equality would be to speaking up when we see injustice. You know, there's injustice in every facet, you know, of our lives. And I think that one of the problems is we don't say anything when we see it because, one, we don't know where to turn. You know, I think that things like the Metropolitan Human Relations Commission that deal with, you know, discrimination at work or in housing, things like that, you know, that needs to be an avenue that more people know about. So when they see injustice happening, they can turn there. And on top of that, I think that there also needs to be a shift into more community relations with police departments. You know, I think that we're really lucky here in Fort Wayne to have a great community relations headed up by, you know, Sergeant Mitch McKinney, who's out there dealing with a lot of community organizations such as the Boys and Girls Club, you know, trying to foster this trust between, you know, citizens and the police force. And I think that if we see more of that all across the country, that's going to go a long way to, you know, helping us come together.
And I want to inject too, I agree about the Fort Wayne Police Department. Mm-hmm. And I think it starts with leadership. And I do applaud Chief Reed for taking the initiative and making sure that his department is a community department and not a militarized, you know, faction of the police. So I think it starts with leadership.
It would be really hard to end racism. It's not going to happen overnight. There's a whole lot of us that don't understand our white privilege, don't understand what it's like to be looked at differently. If we're not aware of our privilege, then we don't think that we have any problem with racism. And that's one of the things. It's too, people have found it too easy to ignore. And we just have to raise awareness and educate ourselves and each other.
You know, we cannot change history and we cannot change the past, but we can change our present and our future.
Yes.
And it's going to take everybody together, loving one another as Christ loved us, to do that.
Yeah, I can't say it any better than Brian Stevenson's grandma. You have to get up close and personal. And I think leaning into those uncomfortable conversations, being humble enough to ask questions where we don't understand, I think all of those are going to contribute to this healthier dialogue that will hopefully, you know, get us to a point of greater understanding and compassion and empathy.
We listen first. We start with listening what others are saying. We listen. And as a person coming from India who had the privilege of education, socioeconomic privilege, so we also exactly grew up that way, where we were, if not consciously cognizant of the fact that we have casteism, where we have the same kind of suppression that happens. And we also have colorism in our own culture, different shades of Indian skin. So I see two different aspects coming from a privileged background and as a person of color in this country.
Well, the thing is, I think first saying that there's privilege does not make the person who's privileged a bad person.
Yes.
So I think people have to get rid of that feeling. It doesn't mean you're bad. I'm privileged in ways too. Like, I had both my parents. I was raised in a very stable home. I wasn't around, you know, chaos or abuse or things like that. Those are all privileges that I have that other people don't. It doesn't make me a bad person. It doesn't mean that I didn't work hard for what I received. It just means that I had a a little bit of a leg up on some of my other counterparts. If you don't have to talk to your children about how to interact with the police, I started when my boys were 8 years old. If you don't have to do that, that is a privilege. And that doesn't mean you're a bad person, but that means you should be wanting to help me with make it the world better for my boys so that we don't have to talk to them about that.
Recently, the Supreme Court ruled against the Trump administration putting an end to DACA. It was more of a procedural how he wanted to end it rather than necessarily upholding the DACA program. So where do you stand on DACA as a program? Do you support DACA or do you think it should be ended?
I support DACA and I support getting people a clear path to citizenship, especially people who have been here almost their entire lives that were brought here as children. And moving forward, we need reform.
It feels like this ruling just sort of kicked the can down the road, and it was a preventative measure, which is great, but we're still lacking the forward movement or the path forward even.
At least if they are allowed to be, first step is permanent residence. That gives them the legal status without visas to just stay. I'm talking that from experience because I'm a legal immigrant and we all were students to H-1, to green card, to citizens. The ones who are under DACA, their process should be a little different than what the rest of us go through the for the green card, which is now not just 5 years, it takes forever now. It's almost 15 years now. At one time, we used to get it within 3 years. So now, just so that their status is legal and this back and forth is not happening, they should have a little different process to approach the green card.
And I would think that this is an opportunity to start fresh. You have a clean slate. Let's create a new designation for DACA people that, whether you want to call that a permanent resident or what, you can then set that up however you want. If you say, yes, you still need to be here for 10 years, great, but then you have a whole separate category that is not going to influence other legal immigration statuses that are just not related.
I'm just waiting to see what's next. I feel like they've been stuck in that DACA status for too long. And I feel like if there's not a reform, or if there's not just a change in DACA, or it's fine if it gets canceled, as long as there's something else for them waiting, you know, like you were saying, the path for citizenship or just something else, not just being in that status all the time.
If you're here, then you need to pursue the citizenship path, in my opinion. You just can't lay low and keep sending money back home and not pay into the system.
What do you mean not paying into the system?
There was an article in the Journal Gazette last Friday about a gentleman who's been here since 1990 that worked in New York City for a Vietnamese restaurant. He came from Mexico. He's been sending $300 to $400 a month back home to Mexico. He was paid off of the books. So that's telling me that the employer is not following the rule.
Following the rule, yeah.
Right.
But if a little town in Mexico is getting over $500,000 a month from family members that are in the U.S. working, then something is not right. And it's cash wire transfers.
There are the loopholes in the system. Mm-hmm. Probably same as in this food processing industry with the farm labor, with the meatpacking industry, where most of them are undocumented immigrants, where the employers, the owners are taking advantage. So it's not just the undocumented immigrants who are breaking the rule or breaking the law. It's right. The legal, local American citizens doing it.
I agree with you on that.
So there has to be repercussions for that for them too.
If there will be a reform that allows them to work legally, that could also, I guess, provide a way for them to pay taxes and to apport the money to the country instead of just sending it outside of the country.
And that kind of plays into another question that I had is, some think that the undocumented workers are a threat to the workforce. Do you see that as taking jobs away from Americans?
I don't know that it takes jobs away from Americans. I think that a lot of those jobs are ones that most Americans don't seem to want.
This gentleman in this article, for 10 years, he's cut meat in the basement of this Vietnamese restaurant. So I know there are people that I know that would not do that. And I probably would not do that. Mm-hmm. So our immigrants are performing and fulfilling jobs that we will not do.
Yeah, I have to agree with Diane. There are jobs available. Mm-hmm. You just gotta look for them.
Amy, I just wanted to clarify, you mean that there are jobs available for Americans who say that there are no jobs for them to get because undocumented immigrants are taking those jobs? Is that
correct.
What you mean?
Correct, yeah.
Yeah.
Even from technical engineering, manufacturing point of view, my husband has been in the industry for the last 30 years, and he's been saying it's become so hard to find technical labor, like welders, machinists, because for the last few years, people do not want to go to the technical schools to get that expertise to get into these. So now the manufacturing industries are also suffering.
When this pandemic started, there was food at the stores because there's illegal immigrants out in farms, like picking up vegetables, picking up fruits. I don't think they're actually taking jobs from American people. They're just doing jobs that need to get done, and somebody has to do them.
House Divided, a year-long project bringing women with different backgrounds and opinions together to see if they can find common ground on divisive issues. Well, this is where our civil conversations would have taken place, in our studio. Six chairs all together, clearly not at a social distance. So our March discussion had to be canceled. Now we're taking House Divided digital and meeting in a virtual chat room. It's another example of how the pandemic is changing how we all live and work, and one of the many aspects discussed by our panelists. I want to do a little bit of a lightning round to start with just a series of questions here. So raise your hand if this applies to you. Raise your hand if you know somebody who has COVID-19. Raise your hand if you are very worried about this pandemic. Raise your hand if you're somewhat worried, maybe a little more applicable. How about if you have lost a job during this pandemic? If you know someone who has lost their job? Raise your hand if you think the federal government has done a good job in the response so far. If you think the state government has done a good job in the response so far. And how about our local government if they've done a good job so far? If you had the ear of President Trump or Governor Holcomb, what is one thing that you would ask for or tell them that you think they need to know?
To President Trump, that would be lead by example in terms of right from as basic as wearing a mask, and then now coming out and saying that he's been using the hydrochloroquine for the last 2 weeks and it's safe to do it. I'm doing it, so it's okay for everyone to do it. What you say and show and everything is about visual more than hearing, and that makes an impact on people.
In a crisis, we need consistency. And at the federal level, we have had none of that. Conflicting advice and changed opinions and hunches and just all kinds of things that have actually made it very, very difficult for anybody to know what to do.
As the president of the United States, you just have to be very careful what you say. And people listen to him because of his, you know, position. Off-the-cuff remark may really significantly affect someone else's life because of his position. So that would be the one thing I would say to him is, you know, make sure that you stay on script.
I feel like he's giving, like, medical advice that he's not qualified to give. Okay, he's a person in the United States, I get it. He has, like, you know, the ultimate word or whatever, but I think from a medical, like, standpoint, I don't think he gets to have his personal opinion.
And one thing that I would mention that we haven't really talked about is, you know, one of the things that concerns me the most about all of this is the disinformation coming out of China. You know, I think that if the Chinese government had been a lot more open about what was happening there, then we would be in the world wouldn't be in the situation that we are in now. I think that costs us valuable time and resources.
We have no control over what China does. We only have control over how we can respond. It's kind of late to play the blame game at this point. I agree. I think they could have given us a lot more information. Our response has to be right, no matter what other countries do.
I agree with